Hi, everyone, and thanks for joining us. This is Stephanie with Wisconsin Clean Cities. Today we're having our biogas webinar. We're going to be reviewing the basics of biogas and its different uses. And these webinars are funded by Fording Wisconsin Fuel Choice, which was supported by the Department of Energy through the Clean Cities Implementation Initiative to Advance Alternative Fuel Markets program. Under these projects, local public-private partnerships are accelerating the deployment of alternative fuel vehicles and conducting public outreach and training in communities across the country. Since 1993, the Energy Department's Clean Cities Initiative has supported community-led efforts to deploy vehicle and infrastructure technologies across a broad portfolio of alternative fuels, helping to reduce America's reliance on foreign petroleum. And Amanda with the State Energy Office is going to kick it off. So take it away, Amanda. Thank you.
Okay, hi everyone. I'm Amanda Mott with the Wisconsin State Energy Office, and I intend to give you a little background on biogas today and an introduction to biogas as a resource and why we are well positioned in Wisconsin to utilize this resource. Joe Kemp with Cornerstone and John Welch from Dane County will be talking in greater detail about biogas for vehicles in Wisconsin. So first I want to talk a little bit about what biogas is. If you can see the corner on the right there, that's methane naturally occurring in the earth, and I smell like that picture, so put it on the slide. But anaerobic digestion is a series of biological processes where microorganisms break down biodegradable material in the absence of oxygen. And one of the end products of that process is biogas, which can then be combusted to generate electricity and heat, or it can be processed into renewable natural gas and transportation fuels, which I'm going to go and Sean will talk about a little bit later. This is a very old technology, and it's recently been realized it can be utilized as a waste management technique or for nutrient cycling and other renewable energy benefits. But on the bottom of the slide, I have a picture of a covered lagoon, and the first covered lagoons were around well over 1,000 years ago, but I think the first anaerobic digester system was used in China. I'm not sure. I think it was China for cooking, but there are many different digester technologies, including the covered lagoon, which you see on the slide. There's a covered lagoon digester, which is a plug flow digester, complete mix digester, and then there's also dry digestion, which we have an example of in Wisconsin at the University of Wisconsin Oshkosh. So there's only two different temperature ranges that digesters operate at. Mesophilic digestion takes place between 38 degrees Celsius in mesophiles, are the primary microorganism, or there's thermophilic digestion, which can take place at around 49 to 57 degrees Celsius. And thermophiles are the primary microorganisms used in that process. But biogas can be produced not only in aerobic digesters, but in areas with organic waste and lack of oxygen, such as landfills. I think John might talk a little bit more about that later. So on the next slide here, I have a map of the amount of digesters. These are on-farm digesters that are up on the right in the United States. That's Wisconsin of 26. I think we're up to more, about 30 now. But we are the leading state for on-farm anaerobic digesters in the state. And we also have a lot of food waste in the state, wastewater treatment plants, and landfill gas energy projects. So in addition to those 30 on-farm anaerobic digesters, we have over 60 municipal digesters and around 30 food processing digesters in the state. So a little bit about the State Energy Office and why we are interested in biogas. Biogas is a very large part of the fuel current investments and complements many of our other investments, such as fuel for transportation. Maria Redman in the office has held a series of natural gas roundtables around the state where she's talked about using compressed natural gas and bio-CNG for fuel for vehicles. But our mission at the State Energy Office here is to increase the use of energy efficiency, develop renewable and alternative energy sources, promote energy-related economic development and jobs, and reduce reliance on imported oil. So for all of those reasons, we are very interested in anaerobic digestion and biogas production in the state. We manage well over $85 million in federal energy-related grants and loans, and have contributed to some biogas projects around the state, such as at the Montev Peace Plant in Belmont, Wisconsin, some small farm biogas digester programs, and the biogas compressed natural gas vehicle fueling stations at Jamesville, wastewater treatment plant in Dane County. So, why biogas? In Wisconsin, we don't have any fossil fuels that naturally occur. But we do have a lot of cows, numerous food and cheese manufacturing facilities. I think we have over 1,000 of those in the state, and lots of wastewater treatment plants. And at all of those locations, there's one thing that they have in common. A lot of waste is produced, and that waste can be utilized in the anaerobic digestion process, produced, as I said before, electricity and heat and compressed natural gas. There are a lot of byproducts that are also produced as a result of the anaerobic digestion process, including separated digestive solids that can be composted or utilized for dairy bedding or directly applied to cropland or converted into other products. Nutrients in the liquid stream are used in agriculture as fertilizer as well. So biogas has been underappreciated as a story in Wisconsin and it's well available across Wisconsin geography, and a range of businesses and resources can invest in this type of opportunity, and it can save Wisconsin businesses money, generate homegrown renewable energy, and drive new business opportunities in manufacturing. The diversity of benefits and the lack of visibility compared to a large wind farm or solar panels are some of the barriers that have been involved with the anaerobic digestion process. We don't say, hey, look, there's a bunch of waste. I want to use that for energy. People like to look at a pre-wind turbine or a solar panel generally. But many farmers and businesses, like I said, can benefit from biogas. So we're just trying to work to spread that word and help become more aware of biogas as a resource. So as I had mentioned, Wisconsin and biogas are kind of a natural fit. I have a picture here. I like the cheese card, although people might be a little bit sad today about seeing that picture after the Packer loss last night. But many of our manufacturing sectors in the state evolved from the dairy industry, and they're very well suited to building biogas systems. So not only, as I mentioned, do we have the waste resources in the state, we also have a lot of manufacturing companies that build the parts that are available for biogas systems. And so we can not only have a homegrown source of renewable energy, we can have Wisconsin companies that are producing all the pieces to use in the anaerobic digestion process. So as I briefly mentioned before, and I'll talk a little bit more in detail about now, there are three main energy uses for biogas. It can be used for electricity. You can burn the gas and run it in a generator to save electricity and provide all-day baseload type of power. It's been used in the state to help utilities meet the RPS requirements. It can be used for cogeneration, which is a very highly efficient use of both of the biogas, which can use it to create both electricity and heat. And it can be used as a vehicle fuel, which we'll learn more about from Jay and John. So biogas energy applications create many opportunities across Wisconsin, and it's adaptive to local needs, like places without access to natural gas or areas of propane or CNG fleet, and areas that are needing electricity. So on this next slide here, I show that biogas energy is affordable and scalable. So it's well within the range of some other renewable sources that we have listed on the screen. The biomass, wind, it's cheaper than new nuclear, new solar, around the same as new coal. So it shows here new natural gas. This is from a little while ago, this slide. But a coworker of mine recently attended the Winter Fuels Outlook for fuel types of fuel resources that we can use, and it's predicted that propane and natural gas are going to start increasing in price this winter. Biogas is also very competitive. So here we just talk about some of the benefits of biogas to agriculture. It can be used for nutrient management, renewable energy, and energy price inflator, new farm income, waste management as well. I think that's about it. I want to talk about on that slide. And this just shows a little bit, this is a map that the University of Wisconsin did a resource on where the resources that can be used for biogas production are around the state, and this just shows where a lot of the dairy production are in the state. And then there's a lot of benefits of biogas to industry and wastewater treatment plants as well. So it's a mature technology that can be used at wastewater treatment plants. Smaller fiscal footprint, it reduces the volume of waste for transport and land application. It's very efficient decomposition, and there's complete biogas capture and nutrient recovery and recycling. Some of the energy benefits are that there's net energy. It's a net energy producing process. There's multiple existing biogas end use applications, as I mentioned before. Heat, combined heat and power, electricity for pipeline quality, biomethane for transportation fuel. It's a baseload and dispatchable energy source versus as compared to like intermittent wind and solar. And it's a direct replacement for non-renewable fossil fuels. There's also economic benefits to using biogas, including jobs. There's temporary construction jobs, and there's also permanent jobs associated with biogas. It turns a cost item, generally waste treatment, into a revenue-generating opportunity, and you can operate it in conjunction with composting operations, and it helps improve rural infrastructure and diversify rural income streams. And so this map here just shows you a little bit of where the feedstocks are and opportunities are with all of our food manufacturing facilities in the state. And that, again, is dairy processing. I didn't know that slide was going to animate. So as I said before, you know, there's a lot of feedstocks and opportunities. Landfills and wastewater treatment plants have been using anaerobic digestion and producing biogas for quite a long time. But they're now deploying these energy systems and using the biogas production to fuel vehicles. So UW system has been involved in a lot of research to develop new frontiers in biogas. As I mentioned before, there's a dry digester at UW Oshkosh, and you can see in the middle here there's a bunch of food just piled up in waiting to be thrown into the digester. At the dry digester at Oshkosh. So they're taking food scraps from local restaurants, from their food services at the university, and using it to fuel this system. So this just shows a lot of the companies in the state of Wisconsin that are involved in producing the equipment that's used in manufacturing anaerobic digesters, some steel vessels and piping, gas engines and compressors, electrical controls, and fueling systems can all be produced here in the state. You see we have Rockwell Automation, TE Energy, Ufemco, Angie, and several others that are involved in this process. So in addition to manufacturing, biogas systems and increased economic activity in the service industry, including engineering, finance, and the legal professions. So we not only have manufacturers involved, but lots of other people that have must get involved in the whole process of building an anaerobic digestion system. So businesses from all over Wisconsin are represented in biogas development and the supply chain, and that is a large reason why the State Energy Office are just really involved in getting this renewable resource out, something that can help develop jobs in the state and increase our the less reliance we have on fossil fuels. So I just want to thank you. I think that we're going to, if you have any questions for me, you're going to ask them right away. This is another little fun thing we get to do at the State Energy Office. We got a call a couple of years ago and Secretary Delcraft was going to be speaking on the Colbert Report. So we found some of the states that are Colbert's head out of cheese, and this is used on the show. So I thank you for your time, and if you have any questions, I think I'll take them right away, or if there's a lot of questions, we might take some later.
Hello, this is Jay Kemp. I'm with Cornerstone Environmental Group and IOC&G. I'm going to kind of pick up where Amanda was leading us to talk specifically about systems that are designed to convert biogas into renewable vehicle fuel. There are several benefits to using biogas as a vehicle fuel. I think Amanda had highlighted that this is a homegrown fuel here in Wisconsin. So from a fleet manager's point of view, it gives you the opportunity to lock in future fuel costs by making your own fuel as opposed to being subject to price fluctuations for other petroleum-based fuels. And renewable natural gas is the greenest vehicle fuel commercially available right now. In other words, it has the smallest amount of CO2 emissions. And then finally, we're able to to process and treat the biogas to a condition where it complies basically identical to CNG vehicle fuel that would be created from natural gas source. So looking at the relative carbon intensity for different vehicle fuels, you can see that compressed natural gas is an advantage over diesel fuel. But the renewable fuels from either landfill gas or particularly if we can do that from a source separator gas stream, similar to UW Oshkosh or other locations where they're running an anaerobic digester on organic waste material. So the goal then is to create a carbon negative fleet of vehicles in the chain of organic waste disposal. And that's what we're illustrating here by creating biogas and then actually running the vehicles on the fuel that's been created from the waste stream. A little bit later, I have a case study for a project in Sacramento that's using our technology and working on this model here. So biofuel G is our process to convert biogas into vehicle fuel. And what's illustrated here is basically our typical modular system. There are some background terms as we get into talking about the vehicle fuel and the fuel in the industry. It's helpful to look at. We often refer to the energy value of the gas in terms of either gasoline equivalent or diesel equivalent. So if you look at the relative energy content there, biogas itself is only about somewhere about 50% methane content, but our upgrading the process will increase that to upwards of 98% methane content. And then finally, RIN is a term that you hear in the renewable fuel business. And what a RIN is a credit that's generated and paid for by fuel producers who do not necessarily produce renewable fuel, but are still required to have a certain amount of renewable fuel in their portfolio. So what it means is that if you are a renewable fuel producer, you can get payments through the RIN program. And the value of RIN is actually traded on an exchange, so it varies day to day, week to week. If you are looking at getting into a vehicle fuel system, you do need to consider a few things about what your plan is, what your goals are for that system. So part of this would be consideration of how many vehicles that you would wish to operate on it. There is this idea of fast fill versus slow fill, and that has to do with how much compressed R&D you would have available. With a fast fill system, the vehicle fills up very similarly to driving up to a gas pump and filling up the vehicle. On a time fill, you're filling at a slower rate, which can be useful for some fleet vehicles overnight. The time fill doesn't require as much compressed gas storage. Then you have to look at your biogas resources and have adequate quantity and quality. And this is all, if you are running a fleet, you need to have natural gas available backup so that you can guarantee you always have an available fuel supply. And then you have any existing infrastructure, either a fueling station, perhaps a power destination system that would already be amenable to expanding into vehicle fuel production. So this is a typical inlet biogas quality that we see from landfills, digesters, and other biogas sources. Again, we're looking at methane 30% to 50%, and we would like to see the hydrogen sulfide at level below 1,000. Some sources we realize are higher than that, which really impacts your operating costs because you have a scrubbing medium that has to be replenished with people. So this is a block diagram of how the bio-CNG process would work. You have a biogas source, and you have to basically condition that biogas to be suitable for the carbon dioxide removal step, which includes hydrogen sulfide removal prior to compressing the gas, removing the ice here, and then using a carbon-based system for siloxanes of DMC. Siloxanes are silica compounds that are found particularly in natural gas or in municipal anaerobic digesters. They're less of a problem with agricultural digesters or food waste digesters. Here's a more of a graphical representation of that system so that you can see how the equipment would lay out on a typical site. The cylinder being the compressed gas storage. The unit with a few columns being our bio-CNG skid, and then the fueling compressor being in between there. So these are the models of bio-CNG currently offered as a standard product. Obviously, you know, different configurations can be available depending upon the specific application, but here's this idea of converting a gas flow into a more fuel production system. So, for example, if you had an inlet flow of approximately 100 SCFM, you could count on producing 400 to 500 gallons of gasoline equivalent per day. Now, the yield of fuel is dependent upon the incoming gas quality. So that's why we show a range and there is some variability in that. So here's just some pictures of how gas fueling works. You connect a compression fitting right up at the fuel tank. You use this valve to open that up and that fills your tank with the gas fill situation here. A tank fill would be very similar. Except you wouldn't be using something that looks like this film sensor that you see there in the picture. So just to get an idea of how our standard size is, which what our product does is make vehicle fuel available to smaller producers of biogas. But you can see that even going up to our BioCNG 100, we could be running a significant fleet of light-duty trucks and even getting into the larger heavy-duty trucks or even the transportation systems. School buses or city buses would be a very good application for this. Basically, any vehicle that's going to return to the same place every day is a good candidate for a fleet owner to own a vehicle, their own vehicle fueling station. So I'm going to go through a few projects here, and I'll be very brief about Dane County because I know John Walsh is going to cover that project as well. Dane County has a lot of biogas. Most of it they use to produce electricity, but they got into the business of biogas towards the end of 2010. Here's vehicle fueling being fueled up in early 2011 with the initial system, and the county has since expanded their vehicle fleet to include more CNG vehicle. And then finally, the new fueling system is a considerable upgrade from the early days. I believe John will give you a little bit more on that story. Another example of biogas to vehicle fuel in Wisconsin is at the Janesville, Wisconsin wastewater treatment plant. There's just some facts about Janesville and the system over here on the slide. You can see their fueling station and their gas compression and cleanup system. Janesville is an interesting story because of the timeline of the project. Originally, they were going to increase the gas utilization through electricity generation using the gas microturbine technology, definitely wanted to add more generating capacity, which involved adding Gaston 200, and then to have a higher value in use for the gas, we also decided to go into vehicle fuel. So this shows the fueling station as and the, because we already have a gas condition system, that was really only necessary to add the CO2 removal component. And then here's the final system installed and functional as of summer 2012. So there's a little more detail about the components that you see on the survey. The whole lawnmower is kind of interesting. That's actually a riding lawnmower fueled by CNG. Gas treatment systems and so forth are inside the building. You can see that low pressure gas storage, in this case, we use a sphere type of high pressure CNG storage. The last case study I want to look at is sort of the big picture of where the management of organic waste is going. This is a project that we have in Sacramento, California. And this is the idea of kind of having 100% of recycling of organic waste to a digester, then the digital processing, and then, of course, the biogas treatment step, leading to the bio-CNG and the fueling station. And they also have coupled this with associated with the microservice, actually an engine generator that they're using at Sacramento. But currently, all of the biogas being produced at the Sacramento project is going into CNG, bio-CNG fuel. So here's a picture of the modular bio-CNG. This is a bio-CNG 100. This is the original unit for Sacramento. And they have since purchased a 200, which will be commissioned this spring. And then here's one of the CNG waste hauling trucks that Atlas Recycling uses. Atlas actually owns and operates the fueling station. So they've made the commitment to go to CNG and renewable vehicle fuel in Sacramento. To finish up, just the high point for Sacramento was originally went into service earlier this year, and then expanding the waste input to the digesters, which is then going to produce more gas, and thus more vehicle fuel, and thus the addition of the expanded vehicle fuel capability. So finally, what we see with biogas to vehicle fuel is this is proven technology. For a fleet owner, this could be the lowest cost fuel, and certainly the long-term outlook. This provides you a price security. The fuel that we produce from biogas works exactly like any commercial CNG fuel, and this is the greenest fuel option that we see out there. And in particular, with our technology, we've made the vehicle fuel option available to smaller generators of biogas than that previously available. So, thank you. I'd be happy to answer any questions now or at the end of the webinar.
All right. This is John Watson with Solid Waste Management in Downtown, and I'm going to talk a little bit about the history and the experiences Downtown's had with CNG, but more specifically with Biogas CNG. I apologize in advance. I was asked to speak like yesterday afternoon, so I kind of threw something together as quickly as I could. But here's a quick overview of the history of Dane County's experience with CNG. We've had quite a bit of experience going back 20 plus years with landfill gas. We have a closed landfill that we're producing renewable electricity off of landfill gas, and we have an active landfill as well. We produce enough electricity for about 5,000 homes, and that ends up with a net revenue after cost for Dane County about $3.5 million that goes back to our taxpayers. And we also have quite a bit of experience with digesters. That was Project Legion, community manure digester here in Boone County. The manure digester with a group of three family farms. And then we also did a feasibility study on looking at food waste digestion as well. So we have quite a bit of experience and history with methane and biogas from both landfills and digesters. Several years ago, we started looking at the possibility of taking our landfill gas and cleaning the entire, all of that gas up and putting it in the natural gas pipeline. That was in 2008-09 when natural gas was about $14 a dekatherm. Natural gas is now about $3 to $4 a dekatherm, so obviously that would not be very feasible. However, we continue to look at what we could do with that gas and evaluate our options, and very similar technology, looking at the technology that clean up the gas, and we thought, boy, can we use that clean up gas in another way? Can we use it to offset vehicle fuel as bio-CNG? Because then the economics start to look a lot better. We're looking at offsetting the cost of gasoline and diesel anywhere from $3 to $4 a gallon. So we received some funding from the state energy office. Wisconsin Clean Transportation Program to Clean City, and we worked on a pilot bio-CNG station at the landfill, a very small system that was put in December of 2010 and end of 2011. We also put in a large CNG station on top of pipeline natural gas at another location in 2011. So I'll talk a little bit about kind of our experiences with those. And we had a little bit of comparison there from natural gas CNG and bio-CNG. Currently, we have about 30 vehicles in our fleet. We now have some that are dedicated to CNG. A lot of them run on a campaign of gasoline that work CNG. Most of our vehicles are 150s, 250s, and 350s. We have some with dump bodies, foil blades, et cetera. We do have a Ford Fusion, a Transit Connect, and those vehicles are spread over 7 different departments. So our medical examiner, parks, highways, solid waste, et cetera. We're working to add probably another 10 vehicles yet in the remainder of this year. We'll be adding vans, pickups, passenger cars. But more importantly, probably more interestingly, we're actually going to be bringing online a plow truck, one of our very, very large plow trucks with the two plow blades that you see running on the interstate or the Beltline in Madison. So we should be receiving delivery of that soon, and that'll be very interesting to us what results we see from that this winter. Typical conversion cost for the vehicles is anywhere from $8,500 to $13,000. Standard lately has been in that $9,000 to $10,000 range. And that's for passenger vehicles. For the larger vehicles, it's a lot more, and it's really tied to the cost of fuel tanks. With those larger vehicles, we need larger fuel storage tanks. So why CNG and why bio-CNG for Dane County? Our experience is it's a financial decision. It's a lot cheaper to produce CNG fuel, less than $2 a gallon, but also we know what that price is going to be moving forward. The actual gas, whether it be pipeline gas or landfill gas, the cost of that is only about 20 to 30% of your full cost of compressed natural gas. There's a lot of cost in capital for the equipment, the electricity required to compress the gas, all types of things. So even if natural gas prices or your landfill gas prices are fluctuating, your total cost of C&E doesn't fluctuate that much. So you're really forecasting gas prices up for a very long time in the future. We're also interested in this because it's a domestic source of fuel. So from a national security standpoint, also from local jobs, these pictures I show here are our equipment, our biogas units can be built down in Dubuque, Iowa, from at the Unison plant. The bottom picture is our CNG compressor being built at Angie in Milton, Wisconsin, now in Gainesville, Wisconsin. So it's truly local jobs. There's a noise reduction with these vehicles as well. It's a lot safer fuel type, and it stands better for the environment. So when I look at environmental benefits, some of this has been covered, but it's a significant reduction in smog producing pollutants and a lower amount of greenhouse gases, and most importantly, a lower carbon intensity. So this is taken from the California carb folks. It's showing the carbon intensity of various types of fuel. The top there you see gasoline, at the bottom it's showing bio-CNG produced from landfill gas. This looked at carbon intensity, as I say, from well to wheel. So it's all of the carbon that is being emitted from the whole process of extracting the fuel from the ground all the way to processing it and then using it in the vehicle. So this is just a really quick look at some of the pictures of our system. The picture at the top is the actual cornerstone system that's cleaning up our landfill gas. It's basically cleaning it to almost pipeline-grade natural gas. And then that clean gas needs to be fed into a fueling station and a compressor system. The bottom left shows the smaller pilot system we had been using for years. It was a 1970s model that had a tendency to break down, but it's hard to complain when we get things for free. So we may deal with that as we are going through the testing phases with this project. We were very happy with the end results, and we ultimately ended up purchasing a larger fueling station, similar to what you see on the bottom right there, and we installed that this year. So our new system now is a BioCNG 50, which can grow 200 to 250 gallons a day of CNG from landfill gas. It has 200 gallons of storage. It has one compressor that can run off of landfill gas, and another compressor as a backup that can run off of pipeline natural gas. In addition, it has two hoses that are backflow hoses, which means they can fill your vehicle just as fast as your normal gas with diesel hoses. And we also, in the future, will be installing four small fill hoses, so we can plug in those hoses, similar to what you would do with an electric vehicle. I think I covered most of this, so I'll go on to the next slide. Some things to consider with bio-CNG. It does require some more equipment. Jay touched upon this, but biogas has some things in it that need to be taken out before that gas can be put into CNG in the vehicles. So there's moisture, there's hydrogen sulfide, there's siloxane, there's CO2, and then in addition, you need to compress the gas, and you need to add odor, typically, the landfill gas. Some other considerations as you look at bio-CNG, there's a lot higher O&M and capital costs for this equipment than there would be just for typical CNG equipment. But that's, I'll show you in a little while, that's offset by some other standards in the system. Also, you have to be able to manage your source of gas, whether it's a digester or a landfill. Especially with landfills, you have to be concerned with the nitrogen. I think Jay showed one of your slides, you want to keep your nitrogen under 5%. And depending on how you're managing your landfill, that can be an issue at times. If it's managed properly, it should not be. Generally speaking, the permitting with the Wisconsin I'll say it was actually very, very easy. It actually, because we have an electric generation system on site and a permit that allows us to instruct the gas already, they basically knew no additional emissions and really no requirements for the purpose. Other consideration is obviously you have the ability here to be getting a much cheaper gas by getting biogas, but you have to offset that with, are you getting other revenues for that gas already? And with that gas too is the RIN, the renewable identification numbers that Jay touched upon, is basically similar to renewable energy offsets for electricity. The large fuel producers and refineries in the world are required to produce a certain amount of their fuel from renewable sources, and rather than do that themselves, they will actually pay you to do that. So we get to use the fuel in our own vehicles, and then on top of that, we get paid from 75 to about 50 gallons a year. So I'll keep on moving. The cost components, I touched upon this a little bit already. It's not just the gas coming in there, it's the capital amortization on all the equipment you put in, it's the operation and maintenance of that equipment, the electricity around the compressor, and there are a lot of your typical fuel and excise taxes at both the state and federal level. It's kind of an overview of some numbers that we ran several months ago on our CNG. Our one CNG station is running off of natural gas, and our other CNG station is running off of landfill gas, bio-CNG. And you see all the things that added up, and at the bottom there's about 240 a gallon over for CNG off of natural gas and 290 a gallon for bio-CNG. Now, I'll point out, this was based off of about 2,000 gallons per month. If you double this to, say, 4,000 to 5,000 gallons a month, then they both end up being about $1.20 a gallon to produce both CNG off of pipeline and CNG off of landfill gas. Anything above that, if you're using more than 4,000 to 5,000 gallons a month, then it becomes even cheaper, and bio-CNG becomes much cheaper than traditional CNG off of landfill gas. And it sounds maybe a little counterintuitive, but if you look at these numbers here, some of the big costs per gallon for bio-CNG are electricity and capital. And that's because there's a lot more electricity to run, a lot more cleanup equipment, and so you have these huge peak electric demand charges. And the capital, obviously, there's a lot more capital equipment. Now, with those large costs, they're essentially fixed. So the more and more gallons that you're putting through them, the more you're bringing the cost down per gallon. And in addition, you see at the bottom there, you can get the RIN, the payback on that RIN for CNG, and I use a very conservative number for that. So some of the other program considerations, if you're looking at bio-CNG or CNG in general, you need to think about the vehicle maintenance. Are there maintenance options in your vicinity? If not, are you going to be providing training for your mechanics? When we started getting into this 4 or 5 years ago, there really weren't any options, and so we kind of take the approach of getting our mechanics trained as much as we can. So we actually had one of the conversion companies come in and train about 15 of our mechanics on some just very general maintenance of CNG engines, and then we actually purchased a diagnostic tool from them at that point as well, so we can read the air flow and try to troubleshoot what's going on. We also have sent a handful of our mechanics for much more in-depth major repair type training, which was about a 2-day workshop off of our site. And we sent about 6 to 8 of our mechanics to in-depth training for major maintenance on the compressor and fueling station, which Andy put that on as a week-long course. So that's the approach we've taken with training so far, just to try and fill a hole that was there when we got into it. It's starting to get better, but it still can be something you want to look into. Also, you must be very aware of what codes and requirements are going to be needed for either parking vehicles inside, for doing minor repairs on vehicles inside, for doing major repairs on vehicles inside, for installing fueling stations on your site. So, the state energy office has just come up with a really good summary of all those requirements. They worked with all the code officials and fire marshals, et cetera, and came up with a pretty good document that outlines that. And also, you're going to have some additional training, whether it's your technicians, like I talked about, your actual drivers. You're going to want to provide training to the department heads. You get the buy-in from the top, and everyone understands the importance of the program and what you're trying to do. some of the hurdles we've encountered would be the vehicle procurement process. So it can go smoothly and has gone as smoothly for us as ordering a vehicle from the dealer and we found one with CMG. They work with the retrofit company and get installed, and we have the vehicle delivered a month and a half later. It can be the worst case scenario, which we saw, was they ordered a vehicle from the dealer, same type of situation, they're going to get it retrofitted aftermarket. And it took us 15 months to get the vehicles. So it really comes down to all of these vehicles are still required to be regulated by EPA and their emissions. So that means they have to go get the engines modified, which is fine as soon as the conversion kit is a modification. EPA has to test and approve that conversion kit. If a new vehicle engine type comes out, say in the 2014 model for an F-150, now the conversion company need to take a look at that new engine, come up with a new conversion kit, go through all the testing with the EPA, get the approval from the EPA, and then they can start installing the kit. So that's where you can sometimes run into delays. That's gotten a lot better in recent years. The manufacturers are starting to work much more closely with approved modifiers and are actually, in many cases, bringing the OEM modification CNG installation company into the factories, Ford and Chrysler factories, and Ford and GM factories. So that's been much better. I think I mentioned training. A lot of times we had to take that on ourselves because there wasn't much available. And there's a sharp learning curve as far as installing human stations, modifying the buildings, the codes, the permitting, all of that, the regulatory agencies, you still have to pay taxes and finding what that process and what forms you have to fill out and when and who you have to submit, and can be a little bit of a learning curve. So with that, I will open it up to questions.
I'm sure.